In 1940s, when India was struggling for its independence, it also struggled with a havoc named malaria. It was one of the major causes of high mortality. It has been reported that in 1947, 21.8% of Indian population, that is approximately 75 million people, suffered from malaria with about 8 lakh deaths. In exploration of a potent and safe tool to cease the escalating cases of malaria, the research to eradicate malaria was started by CSIR CDRI way back in the 1970s. But the incidence of drug resistance brought CDRI's focus on malaria to the center stage.
Over the last several years, groups in the institute have looked at basic pathways for biology of these diseases, as well as led research programs that have identified and screened for new molecules. In 1997, as is well known, a new drug from CDRI was released. It's called EMAL or alpha beta art ether. It was marketed in 1997 by Themis and has now reached a stage where this is part of the national program for malaria. The drug is targeted to kill and address the issue of severe malaria, as well as to target chloroquine resistant malaria parasites. After the success of EMAL, our groups have also been looking at other molecules, and we currently have a molecule 97x78 which is under phase 1 clinical trial, the permission for which has been received from the director from the DCGI. We also have a lead molecule and another lead molecule that we are looking at, and it's in the preclinical stages of drug development.
The resurgence took place mostly due to development of drug resistance in malaria parasite. CSIR CDRI and CSIR CMAP, with their combined efforts, found that among many anti-malarial compounds, alpha beta art ether was most active and potent against falciparum malaria. It was commendable that no drug-related adverse pharmacological effect was reported and no significant effect was observed on central nervous system and cardiovascular system or urinary system. The major advantage of alpha-beta artheta injection over beta artheta, artemether or artesunate, is its short three-dose injection schedule with high efficacy against multidrug-resistant P. falciparum, P. vivax infections, etc. Additionally, it also has the ability to stop malaria transmission via its gametocytosidal activity. In 1986, for the control of drug-resistant malaria and as a potential compound for the control of cerebral malaria cases, CDRI and CMAP Lucknow were directed to develop alpha beta art ether as a fast acting blood schizontocyte. In 1990, alpha beta art ether was patented as a novel blood schizontocyte.
Now, malaria, leishmaniasis, and filaria are looked at by various groups in the institute. We have, on the one hand, a screening program that actually screens randomly, in the sense that medicinal chemists design molecules and synthesize molecules, and these come into the screening program and we look at their effects on the growth of these parasites. Apart from the phenotypic screen, once we have positives, these go up into the in vivo models where we look for activity, and if we have positives in this and if these are also targeting drug resistant lines, these go in for further development activities also in house. The other way of doing work and looking for new molecules is to actually understand parasite biology, which is to say that we try and look for new pathways and proteins that are essential for parasite growth and survival, understand their functions, look at their structures, try and see if we can rationally design molecules against them, and then go and look at the effects of these molecules. As you would understand, this requires a great deal, this is basic science. So what you are looking at then is the biology of the parasite, whether it be malaria or leishmania or filaria. to understand how this grows, what pathways are essential for it, both in the human as well as for transmission stages, and then to see whether we can actually have these proteins made and their structures analyzed. We have groups that look at basic major biochemical pathways, do biochemistry and cell biology to understand how these function, do genetic knockouts to look at whether these proteins are essential for activity and survival of the parasite. In the last few years, these groups have expanded, whereas earlier we were looking more in the animal models and trying to do drug discovery and development through actual screens, both in vitro and in vivo screen.
For the exceptional contribution as a new anti-malarial drug, the Central Drug Research Institute and Central Institute of Medicinal and Aromatic Plants, Lucknow, were jointly awarded CSIR Technology Shield for developing Alpha Beta R-Theta. Alpha Beta R-Theta was a huge market success and made extraordinary sale of rupees 90 crore. Alpha Beta R-Theta was acknowledged globally when it was made available in the countries like Nigeria, Ghana, DR Congo, Kenya, Zambia, Malawi, Rwanda, Myanmar and Cambodia with a sale of 4.75 lakh doses in 2015. Ebal has been a savior, curing 30 lakh people in a span of 1 year. By June 2016, Ebal grew from 87 products in 2010 to 175 products. Keeping in mind the demand of an effective anti-malarial drug with minimum side effects, the maximum retail price was dropped from rupees 400 in 1997 to rupees 80 in June 2016. Making its route strong in India, Alpha Beta R-Theta is focusing its market in Africa, South Africa, Asia and America. Before releasing the drug into the market, four-phased clinical trials were conducted under the guidance of Drug Controller General of India, spanning over 7 years from 1989 to 1996. After successful results on rats and rhesus monkeys in phase 1, the trials were organized in 7 centers across India. The trial was completed in 267 patients of uncomplicated malaria and 211 patients of complicated falciparum malaria. The cure rate was 97% and 93.3% respectively.
In the last several years, the institute has expanded to include a number of people who actually look at biochemistry, cell biology, structural biology, and then try and look at approaches for new drug discovery and development. We have several areas that we look at. For instance, if I talk of malaria, which is my field, we have in the organism an organelle called the epicoplast, which is very similar to plant plastids. And my group looks at ways in which this plastid functions, how it replicates its own genome, how its proteins are translated, what translation factors are required, how its genome can be repaired, and various other biochemical pathways in the parasite. If we can understand how these function and whether these are important and essential for growth of the parasite, we can look at ways in which we can inhibit these. Similarly, other colleagues look at other mechanisms. They look at how secondary, tertiary structures in DNA of the parasite are important, how these can actually interact and regulate certain pathways, and whether we can inhibit specific DNA structures. We also have in recent years got a very strong group on liver biology in malaria, which uses the Burgheim model, and we can actually generate knockouts in the Burgheim model to study the essentiality of specific malaria proteins. Similarly, in the Leishmania group, we have a number of people looking at essential Leishmania pathways, trying to understand functions, looking at drug resistance in the field, and to see how this drug resistance gets generated. So we have overall, apart from our screening systems, which are screening systems that look at in vitro, functional effects of molecules, apart from the in vitro and in vivo screening models, which are both models for that utilize the mouse system for malaria as well as the other systems for Leishmania and filariasis, and we go up to the primate model for malaria, where we also have monkey models that look at primate malaria. Apart from these systems which are involved in screening, we also have diverse groups that look at basic molecular pathways and mechanisms and biochemistry, some of which I had described earlier. So we have in place a system which is ready not only to identify molecules but also look for mechanisms of action, that's one part, and also in another way first identify protein pathways and proteins that should be inhibited and then do rational drug design and then see the effects of these drugs.
In the post-marketing surveillance, clinicians and patients confirmed the safety and highlighted excellent tolerability and proved the effectiveness of 3-day schedule of our theater for treatment of falciparum malaria.
Now this activity cannot go towards translation if we don't have a strong backup of preclinical analysis. And in our institute, the major strength is that we have scientists here whose expertise is in preclinical evaluation, so that as molecules progress and go up as lead molecules, we can simultaneously look at their pharmacokinetics, look at their pharmacology, look at their toxicity in very detailed schedule by kind of parameters. So we have in place a system wherein we can move faster and we can move with a lot of inputs from other teams which look at preclinical analysis, and this helps us grow as a team looking for drug discovery aspects.
There is no substitute for hard work, and hardworking people don't sit back and relax. Great work needs consistency, and CDRI has been consistent to make our theater a better compound from the day of its initiation, and is still working to make malaria drugs better than before.